I'm leaving it in.
Picture this. Do it, you coward.
It's a Sunday. You're sitting at home and you're thinking, man, I wish there was a new episode of Podzilla 1985 for me to listen to. Well, I've got good news for both of you. There is. It's tonight, without any kind of fancy intro, we're here to talk about the Xbox 2024 showcase. This is a very special episode. We're going to call it Nerdish. Anthony Anderson will be here a little bit later to round out the cast. But until he gets here, let me introduce everybody. My name is Shannon Young. I'm going to be your host, sort of. It's not really a hosty show tonight. We're just going to be talking about things. But with me, of course, I have the former host of Nerd Up and also the Hype Train and Penta Nerd.
Oh, man. And throwing it back now.
Throwbacks. Yeah. It's Jesse Kimball.
Hey, yeah.
On a Sunday.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for tuning in.
I should have just let you take it, honestly. I shouldn't have stolen it from you. Really quick, let me turn my camera on so that everyone at home can see me too. Because I guess they can't really see anything. But Hunter's on, so
Jesse should too.
Yeah, Jesse absolutely should.
I'm not going to be the only one. Hey, it's not going to be me.
Hey, that voice you hear.
What the hell?
That's double H. What? What's going on?
You look like...
What is happening?
What is your camera?
Oh, I don't have
what
my
did you connect to?
My camera fell off my computer.
It looked like you connected to the void.
Hold on. I got you.
I thought at any second you were going to tell me to enjoy my new landline.
My bad. Hey, it's double H.
Oh, that was wild. Yeah. Hey, guess how big Call of Duty is going to be?
No.
I saw it.
Did you look?
Wait, hold on. Okay, hold on. Before they announce it, it should be noted that Call of Duty Black Ops Cold War was ridiculously large, and I think they promised that they weren't going to do that anymore, that future Call of Duties were going to be better. So how big is this one?
This is taken directly from the headline from IGN that NASA threw in the group chat a minute ago. Xbox website says Call of Duty Black Ops 6 weighs in at an eye-watering 309.85 gigabytes.
Oh my god!
Mm-hmm. That is a massive game. Like, I've got to wonder if that's like the Warzone
zombies.
The pull quote from it says that it may be the case that this is a worst case scenario for the game if the other Call of Duty games are also installed, or indeed includes Battle Royale, Warzone, etc., etc. Because of course this is the new Call of Duty HQ launcher.
Well, so first off, I wasn't gonna drink, but you forced me to.
Yeah, I knew he'd find a way to pin it on me. Somehow or another.
You had to tell him about the 310 gigabytes.
But also,
I did.
Right now, Modern Warfare is sitting at about 260 gigs. So there's no way that Black Ops by itself is only 100 gigs.
In fairness, I think you can clean that up. Like, you can clean up that installation and lower it.
Can I take the snipers out of the game? How many megabytes does that free up?
To their credit, the current launcher does occasionally, when you go to it, like if I haven't launched it in a while, it'd be like, hey, by the way, you still have the campaign installed. You done with that?
Yeah.
Like, you can get rid of that if you're done with it.
I've already uninstalled
it. You don't play Warzone. You done with that? You can get rid of that.
It's already gone.
It still seems like it takes up a shit ton of space.
260 gigs at least by itself. That's only for the multiplayer. That might include zombies. God. I think I still have the zombies mode on there, which is basically Warzone, but...
It's just like how TV and streaming is just becoming cable again. Like, eventually they're going to go, you know, we could just put all of this in, like, a cartridge.
Yeah.
You could just have, like, a single cartridge for this game, and then you just plug that into your system when you want to play it.
No, and you can get cute with it. You could put a big sign on the cart that says, blow me. Because that's what, I feel like that's what they're saying to us right now.
Yeah, well, I'll give you that one. I'll give you that.
That's pretty intense. So thank you. Important safety tip from Egon there. Tanner's here, but we're not sure if he's here. All right. Tanner Calvert may be joining us a little bit later here on the show. We'll find out. So I woke up this morning. We don't normally do shows on Sunday. We used to do one of my favorite shows on Sunday. We called it Sunday Random Sunday. That was a good time. Until it was one day, nobody was available. And I think it ended up just being me, CJ, and like Ethan. That was not a good show. That was not an enjoyable time. I love both those guys.
That was also basically the first Nerd Up, almost.
Yeah, that's pretty true. Yeah, well, that was, what was it, me, CJ,
Ethan, CJ, and me.
Yeah.
Ouch.
Yeah.
That was a show.
Well, speaking of a show, speaking of excitement and Waka Waka, I got up this morning.
Waka Waka.
I sat down, I had my coffee. It was great coffee. Really good coffee, but it's dark, and my phone's just buzzing like crazy.
You sound like you're doing the sunny bit, and it was great. It was pretty good. It was okay.
It wasn't that great.
It wasn't great, but the important part is
I got my caffeine. My phone starts buzzing, and no, there's no cheese on it, Jesse. We saved that for the weekday. We saved that for weekdays or Saturdays. I don't know, whatever day it was.
Cheese coffee.
Yeah, over at Manatee, cheese coffee. You get a nice cheesy, foamy layer on top. You filter the coffee through it.
Oh.
Yeah, it's kind of like a little bit of a cream cheese. Basically just like a sweet foam with some of that like cream cheese tang to it.
Yeah, the tang.
Okay. I'm getting more on board. I'm not fully off the dock yet, but I got to tell you, when you first mentioned this, I'm picturing a block of cheddar just sitting on top of my coffee cup, and I was like, why?
Well, no.
Why would you do this?
You put the cheddar in the coffee, and then when it's nice and soaked, you pull it out and start cutting off pieces of it. See, it's Kaz has the hottest, wettest cheese available. Over at Discounts.
There's no chance he listens to this.
Not at all.
But is it any good, Seanán?
No. Well, it's hot and cheesy and wet.
I was about to say, there's the actual.
So while I'm enjoying my coffee, I start my phone is just buzzing like crazy, and I'm like, what the fuck's going on? The first thing I do is I pop in, and someone, I think it was Jesse, said something about either Fallout or somebody said Doom, and I went, right, the Xbox showcase is today. I forgot about that. So I turned it on and watched the rest of the show, and even though I missed like probably the first 20 minutes of it, the last 30 minutes of it was still spectacular.
The whole showcase was just like hit after hit after hit after hit with very little of that like really awkward dude standing in front of you talking.
I appreciated that big time.
Whole showcase. Yeah. It was just like Seanán made the joke in the fucking group chat. Just like people have been asking where are the games, and Xbox is like, here they is.
Here are the games, and there was a whole bunch of them. There's something for everybody in this thing. I mean, I really can't. I know we joke around and we're very satirical, but in our tone. But this is one of those times where everything, man, they just hit on all cylinders. There's so many amazing games that they had on here. We haven't done like a video game exclusive show in a long time. In fact, Hunter, I think the last time we did one really exclusive was me, you, Asa, and Dalton during E3, and that was years ago.
Yeah, did we not do one last year? That would have been the last time I could think that we would have done anything like that.
That's when I started drinking.
I don't even know what we would have categorized that as. I can go look, but I legitimately cannot remember the last time we did something like this.
One of the problems, I think, with the show as it is right now is we have such a good schedule where every show is, okay, you know what's coming week to week. We don't break away from that very, very often and just do a random show. That's why I'm glad we're doing this here tonight. This is out of the usual. Hunter sent a list, everything we saw at today's Big Xbox Showcase. This is from Kotaku. If you didn't see this, by the way, make sure you go online, check it out on YouTube. We're going to talk about the games and how excited we are about them. But it was a fantastic showcase. Really blew my socks off. I almost got
a cup of coffee. You're right, by the way. The last time that we did an E3 review as far as it's marked gaming on the website was 2019, and it was exactly the four people that you mentioned.
Yeah.
It was Tuesday, June 11th, so almost 5 years to the day.
Wow.
I wonder what the
big games were.
2019. Yeah, 2019 we still had Nerd Up.
I'm looking it up real quick. I'm kind of curious about
this. That's true.
So E3 2019.
You did an episode of Nerd Up just right before that on March 24th.
So here's the games that Microsoft. Oh, let's just, as a comparison, let's talk about what Microsoft talked about in 2019. The last time we talked about it, we're just going to talk about Microsoft and Bethesda. I think those are the most apropos to talk about right now. So Microsoft, first off, they announced Project Scarlet, which, as we know, would go on to become the Series X.
And have nothing to do with the color red, but yes.
Nope. They also...
I mean, Project Scorpio, they go on.
They also announced of The Outer Worlds, Bleeding Edge, Ori and the Will of the Wisps, which I know Kaz is a big fan of, Minecraft Dungeons.
Outer Worlds was really good, too.
Worlds was really good. I like that one.
Yeah.
Minecraft Dungeons, Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, Blair Witch. I thought that might get Tanner back. Okay.
I'm here.
Oh, shit.
It worked. You summoned him.
You mentioned the Blair Witch and he appears. Cyberpunk 2077. Wow. That was that show. That was the Keanu Reeves one.
Okay. But I was going to say, did they announce it there or what were they talking about at that time?
I'm pretty sure
it came out in 2020.
That's when Keanu Reeves came out there and was like, ugh.
It's going to be...
That's why Keanu Reeves in person. What? That's good. Okay.
That's your Keanu, huh?
That's my Keanu.
Why is it so similar to your Kirk Van Houten is what I'd like to know.
Cyberpunk.
So importantly, like, I'm not hearing a whole lot of exclusive titles.
Oh, hold on. I'm still going.
We're just talking about 2019. Go ahead.
Spiritfarer. Here's your exclusive title here, Jesse. Battletoads. Set the World on Fire. The Legend of Wright. Okay, here's a really good exclusive one. Microsoft Flight Simulator, which was a fantastic game. That was a showcase game for the Series X. That was one of those games that you want to impress your friends, show them Flight Simulator. Even if they don't play it, it's just awe-inspiring just to see it. We'll talk more about that a little bit later, too, by the way. Age of Empires 2 Definitive Edition. God, this is sad. Wasteland 3, which I played and really liked. Psychonauts 2, Lego Star Wars The Skywalker Saga. It's also a good game.
The last two, I don't think, were Xbox exclusive.
They were not. Ball Z Kakarot, 12 minutes, which I have no idea what that is. Way to the Woods, Gears 5, there you go. Dying Light 2, Horizon 4, Lego Speed Champions, State of Decay 2, Fantasy Online 2, Crossfire X, Tales of Arise, which I still need to play, Borderlands 3, and Elden Ring, which, of course, was also not exclusive to the system.
Yeah, very few of those were exclusive to the console.
Right.
Yeah.
Bethesda, meanwhile, announced Fallout 76. Well, it wasn't announced. It was featured. Which, I guess 76 and 19 was still in a bad way. They were still trying to find their legs.
It got announced in 2017?
I believe so. I want to say yes to that.
Seems right. I'm looking
at it. 20, yeah, because it came out in 2018. So
I was going to say, because I was out of radio by 2018. Yeah, it wouldn't have been...
So yeah, Fallout 76 is definitely still a mess by that point.
Yeah, I still play it.
Bethesda kept...
Yeah. In fact, I think that's about the time I was playing. I would wait till the girlfriend went to bed, and then I would go sneak into my other room and play it with Marco Stunt. Me and him would play Fallout 76.
Do you know how many people miss that, by the way?
Yeah.
Like, the Fallout 76 subreddit now is full of people who are like, God, it's full of people who are like, I miss the way the game used to be. Like, I'm glad there are other players playing it. I'm not saying I miss people, but they're like, I miss the solitude. I miss when it was very just open and like empty, and there was just nothing, you know, you felt like you were the only person around. Other than just the other few people on the server.
Which kind of makes sense, because that was the point of the story, was that you were the first people to emerge from 76. But I also like the fact that they are treating it as, okay, well, years have passed now, and people have started to settle.
And it's different.
Yeah. No. Elder Scrolls Blades, which was awful. I tried to play that game. That was the cell phone game.
Yeah.
I tried to play that. I couldn't do it. Ghostwire Tokyo, Elder Scrolls Online, which had already been out for a while, Commander Keen Mobile, jacking off right now. The Elder Scrolls Legends. I don't even know what that is. What is that?
Nope. I have no idea.
It's a free to play digital card game. Is that maybe their shelter type
game? Oh, yeah. So it's their shelter type game.
Rage 2, Wolfenstein Cyberpilot, Wolfenstein Youngblood, Deathloop, and Doom Eternal. So
Deathloop and Doom Eternal were good.
I say, at least we had those. Well, compare that to this year. Because, boy, Xbox and Bethesda and everyone else just pulled your pants down, grabbed your little boy dick, and just jerked it off until air came out. Because this thing...
God damn. Why?
Not everyone watches I Think You Should Leave. So not everyone is going to get the bit.
Hey, I have watched a lot of I Think You Should Leave and didn't get that bit.
Well, if Cecily Strong is listening, she got it.
Jesse Magician suck, and he ruined his fucking life.
I make twice as much as that guy, Hunter.
Yeah, well, you wouldn't know it by the suit.
Oh, let's go in the order that they have here on Kotaku. This isn't in the order of it was revealed, but let's talk about them. Just easy way to do it.
Is it not? Hang on, because I can get you the actual order it was released. That's on Destructoid. I've got both of them pulled up.
It might be. I see Call of Duty first. Did they announce Call of Duty 6 and then circle back? Okay.
I mean, there's the Destructoid one if you want it, but it should be the same thing, basically.
Okay. I trust you. All right, so yeah, so this is an order of reveal then. So we started off with Call of Duty Black Ops 6, which I am incredibly excited about. One of my most excited ones. Everyone here knows that it very much started with me, Jesse, Kevin Schenkelberg, Bob, and Matt Sin at my apartment every Sunday playing the original Black Ops, eating Papa John's pizza or Little Caesars. It was a great time, and we loved the first Black Ops. Years went, and then we came back to Black Ops a couple of years ago with Double H and Kaz jumping into Cold War, which became my favorite shooter. We put so much time into it, and though we've played the other Call of Duty games, nothing really scratches that itch like Black Ops. So. Mm-hmm. Here we are again.
Yeah, I was originally really excited to get the Modern Warfare games because I was like, I really prefer the more, you know, modern take on stuff. I liked the 80s, but they went straight to Vanguard after that. I don't give a shit about World War II. So Modern Warfare came around. I got super excited about that. No, I'm ready. I'm ready to go back to Black Ops. Yeah. You remember, I got Black Ops on a whim. Yeah. I wasn't even going to do that. I didn't play stuff online really at all at that time. And then we got the Series X, and I had a bunch of extra trade and stuff. And I'm like, well, what do I get? I got Assassin's Creed because I liked action-adventure games. And I ended up getting Black Ops on your recommendation just because I had a free six-month trial to Game Pass. I think I played Assassin's Creed for like 2 days. Yeah. I was like, I'm never going to come back to this because I'm just playing Cold War. We played Cold War for like 6 or 8 months straight.
It was
like
ridiculous.
That's all we were doing.
It was so much fun. It hit on all cylinders. Yeah.
Like, the maps were great. Like, that was just a really, really solid Call of Duty.
I mean, that came out in November, and I remember we played it all the way up until I went on vacation to Disney the next, like, May. So it was at least 6 months straight. Yeah,
I have a picture. It's on my Instagram of, I think, all of us, including Kaz and Asa, I think, in the lobby when the game came out, playing it, so talking about
how
we roll deep. And it wasn't just that, it was also the zombies mode, which was the best zombies mode, which is the biggest bummer about Call of Duty 6. They said, Jesse, so many times during this, they said specifically round-based zombies. They said that, they made sure to call that out, and that is disappointing.
Yeah, and I mean, I know that's like, that's the fan favorite, that's how it started, but like, I did not like zombies before we had that, like, overworld thing where we had like the last zombies that we played. Was it Modern Warfare 2?
Two and three. It's because it's the same fucking game.
2 and 3 was the same one.
Yeah.
Modern Warfare 2 zombie mode is the first time I've ever had fun playing zombies.
Yeah.
Did you say Modern Warfare 2 was the first time you had fun playing zombies?
Yeah, that was the first one that did that open world thing, right?
No, Black Outbreak. Ops, Cold War.
Outbreak was in Black Ops.
Yeah.
I don't know. I played it with you guys in Black Ops.
Oh, you never played the Cold War?
Surely you did, because we played the shit out of that.
We played a lot of that one.
I know. I think we played a lot along with... it was 3 or 4.
4.
But we had Asa, we had Steven in it. I feel like Kaz. Me, you, and Kaz were kind of the regulars, and then Steven, and I thought Jesse rotated in there, too.
I could have sworn I did.
I just don't remember it.
I found that picture, by the way. It was Kevin. It was the three of us, Kevin and Asa, that played.
Kevin also got a pretty hard back at Call of Duty with us.
Because we were playing against Sausage there and Turtle Time 14.
Don't sleep on Turtle Time 14, Hunter. other than the zombies thing, I thought it looked really good. I'm a little worried about their new movement system, this Omni movement, because...
I'm also a little concerned about it.
Yeah, I feel like that could be very griefy, depending how it goes.
That's what I need people who are really good at moving in Call of Duty to do, be better at it.
Right.
That'll be great for me.
I am interested to see, they talked about, and this is all like, this happened after the showcase for anybody listening. They did a whole like Black Ops 6 breakdown. Yeah. And the other thing they talked about was they're adding in smart settings for like smart crouch, smart sprint, and all this other stuff.
That's pretty neat.
To help people that aren't particularly great at the movement stuff.
Right.
I don't know how that's actually going to work out in game. I'm curious about it. Well, I'm going to be really upset if even more people are able to like crouch at me.
Well, no, what I'm hoping is that you get the people that aren't good at it, and they're just running forward, and they just automatically vault over right in front of us, and we gun them down because they have no idea what they're doing. That will be funny.
Or their game automatically makes them crouch. And Seanán, what makes us miss more than anything else in that fucking game?
If you crouch in front of me, you might as well put an invisibility cloak on. I have no idea.
Like I'm hot now. I'm playing Call of Duty.
I'm a T-Rex.
Crosses in front of me.
Yeah,
it's irritating.
And if you lay down in front of me, I'll trade the game. Then it's over.
May as well be a dead body.
Right.
They do have the new streamer settings, which I think are good for non-streamers too, where you can change up your HUD for the first time.
That's very cool.
In different locations on the screen. Launching with 12 maps for. The 66 core multiplayer, and then more than that, but 12 specifically for that. New maps, they said specifically we want to go back to what people know and what they like the best, the 3-lane style maps with, you know, a variety of sizes of maps. So just say Nuketown. Just fucking say Nuketown.
Just say Nuketown.
Please. Like what? Nuketown. Just say it out loud.
Yeah.
Nuketown is coming back in the same way that Shipment has been in every fucking game.
Oh, God. For the past 14 years, it feels like.
Because they didn't put shit in Cold War, though, did they?
No.
I know they put it in Vanguard and Modern Warfare.
The first time I played it was in Vanguard.
I feel like Vanguard was the first time, but I wouldn't doubt it because it's also a fan favorite. But
They put Shipment on Modern Warfare 1, the 2019 version.
Yeah.
Because that's where I got good at Shipment, because me and Kevin, he and I, the way we play that game, the way we have fun is by unlocking camos.
It's a bad map.
And shipment is really, really effective for unlocking a lot of those challenges.
He used the word effective. That's not the same.
When you care more about unlocking skins than you do about having a decent KD, you go to Shipment.
And I mean, like, Kevin and I got really good at Shipment. Like, I pretty regularly went positive on there, and sometimes, like, big time positive.
I would still prefer Nuketown. And here's another thing I want, Black Ops. Jesse and I talked about this earlier. Just include all of the maps from the original Black Ops. I don't think...
That would be fantastic.
There was like one or two maps from the original Black Ops I didn't like, but for the most part, it was banger after banger after banger.
Because we've only gotten Jungle brought back once. Yeah. And I fucking love that map.
Fucking Jungle.
Need Jungle. I need Firing Range. I need Nuketown.
Firing Range is one of my all-time favorite.
I need a Ray. I need all of them. They were the best maps to me. Another thing I'm going to beg. I beg of you. I don't know if they took this out of Call of Duty just because Marie and I broke up, but I need Prop Hunt. I want Prop Hunt back.
The last time we had it was in Cold War. Yeah. So, in
Fortnite, but that one kind of, it was fun for
Call of Duty. While. Yeah. I was going to say, I mean Call of Duty exclusively. No, we had fun with the Fortnite one. But
not as much as the Call of Duty one, though. God, I love that fucking mode.
I'm really excited about how good the story looks.
Yeah.
I'm one of the few people I think that plays these games. Well, originally I only played them for the story. I only ever played the first three Black Ops games for the story. Never touched the multiplayer because I wasn't playing online at the time. It looks like they've really put some effort into crafting a nice actual story campaign mode for this.
I love the story mode for the Black Ops games.
Well, especially the Cold War one was awesome. Because, again, when I got it, I wasn't planning on playing online with you guys. I was just going to play it for the story and be done with it. And then I got coaxed over to the dark side. But the story for that was fucking great.
You know, so one thing we won't have back for this one, other than Outbreak mode, we're not going to have that lobby music for Black Ops from Cold War.
Oh, yeah.
Which is arguably the greatest song maybe in a video game. If you ever want to hear it, it's on Spotify. It's called Rising Tide. It's ridiculously good.
Very good.
They also mentioned that there's like a three, I forget the way they worded it, but it's broken up into kind of three camps. There's the people that are always on the run and they're like the aggressors. There's the intel people who kind of play defensively, and you have like the gadgets that you see through walls and stuff like that. And then there's the thing for the people who like hit the points and like shield that. So basically it's almost like me, Hunter, and Jesse right there. And Tanner, because Tanner, I think, would also fall into the more defensive type. That feels like it's really speaking to our playstyles. I'm curious to see how well that goes. It looks great all
over. I'm excited about it.
Yeah.
Day one Game Pass, too. I don't think we've said it out loud, but importantly, first time ever, day one Game Pass. You don't have to purchase the game separately. Could not be more excited about that.
I only have to buy one copy this year instead of two.
You do not have to buy any copy.
Like those adaptive triggers.
We'll want it on PC, so I will be picking it up there. But
well, you have Ultimate Game Pass, right? It's going to come to PC Game Pass too.
Is it? Because I didn't see. I don't. Because it wouldn't surprise me if it would only come to console.
Every game that has come out for Game Pass on Xbox that is on PC so far that I've seen has come out on PC too. So even Starfield. So fingers crossed.
Diablo 4 is not on Game Pass on PC.
Well, that. And moving on to the next game.
I just assumed he was going to kill his camera. I was waiting on it. Well, excuse me for a moment.
We'll see where it goes. But yeah, we're very excited about Call of Duty. We can't talk about it on NFL. Let's move on to this. Oh, God. Well, whoa. Hey. Doom the Dark Ages. What a weird game.
Hell yes.
Looks so cool.
Yeah.
It looks awesome.
I'm going to tell you, I'm going to let you in on a secret, though. I loved the first Doom remake, the one that came out in 2016 or 17 or whatever. Yeah. I absolutely sucked at Eternal. I was terrible. Because it requires nonstop movement, nonstop killing and health stuff. It has one of the greatest soundtracks I've ever heard in a video game. I still play that soundtrack in the morning sometimes to get me hyped, but I sucked at that game.
The soundtrack in this fucking trailer... I was just like, God damn, this is cool. I'm fucking hyped.
You gotta rip and tear until the work is done.
I wonder if they got Mick Gordon back. I know they had a falling out over Eternal, so I think someone else is doing the music now, but it sounded incredible. And this game looked incredible. He's got a shield, Jesse.
He's got a shield. He can throw it through people, Captain America style.
With a fucking chainsaw around it.
That's exactly correct, yeah. It's the edgiest version of Captain America.
Oh.
I'm curious to see what the story is for this, because everyone kept telling me it was Medieval Doom. It's not Medieval Doom. It still has a very modern aesthetic, kind of.
Because he gets launched out of a spaceship at the beginning, but it definitely it has a medieval aesthetic.
Yeah.
But I was going to say, they're calling it dark fantasy. I think they made a point to say, and I'm going to look real quick. Yeah, early in the trailer, they say before he became a hero, he was the super weapon of gods and kings, which makes me think this is technically a prequel.
I gotta know what this bad boy's about.
He's riding a dragon around.
Oh, there's nothing more fun than playing Doom. Doom. I'm glad Doom had such a renaissance. You know, I'm glad it came back, because Doom was always one of my favorite series, and I'm very excited to play this. Also, day one on Game Pass, right?
Day one Game Pass. Yep. 100%.
Oh, here's one we can skip past pretty quick. State of Decay 3. I'm not saying it's a bad game. I liked State of Decay 2. Bob played the shit out of it. Bob was a big fan.
Yeah.
If they change it up a little bit and make it multiplayer, which I think the second one was, I'm not sure about the first one, and give you the ability to pick who you play as, create them as opposed to giving you sets of people that you choose from, I would enjoy it more. But this potentially could be that zombie multiplayer game we always wanted to play. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, what was I going to say about it? The trailer is very good. The whole time, though, I was like, it's very cinematic, it's very neat, but this looks like every zombie game I've ever... Yeah. And then the title came up, and I went, oh, okay, yeah.
Yes.
Also, exactly, Shannon, I stand corrected. Diablo 4 PC is on PC Game Pass.
You know what? I think Jesse Kimball admitting he's wrong. Let's I think he deserves it. I didn't know that. I didn't know that. I didn't know it was on Game Pass, but that is good.
Yeah. I was sure that it wasn't, because you still got the Blizzard launcher, and that's
right.
There's no way I haven't synced up my Xbox account and gotten games for free there.
Yeah.
But I decided just to look it up just to, be sure, and yeah, sure as shit, it's on there.
That's good news. That means I'll have it on PC, Xbox, and PS5 when I purchase it. Moving on. Moving on from State of Decay 3. Hunter, you're going to have to help me with this one, because two reasons. One, this is the only trailer I didn't see. And it's also a game that I'm not super jazzed about because I was never huge into Dragon Age, but I know you are.
Yeah, Dragon Age the Veilguard. So it just recently got a name change because Jesse will tell you this game was called Dreadwolf for a long time before that, or at least it was supposed to be. Jesse's looking at me like he's not going to tell me that. I thought we both played these games, but now I'm very confused.
No, we both did. Okay. I played the absolute shit. I still haven't played Inquisition.
Oh, okay.
Because the way Inquisition worked, I bought that day one, very similar to Andromeda, and then I decided I started playing Inquisition eventually, and my problem was I started playing a new character class because I was like, I want to try something different, and I did with like this dual wield rogue build that like I never play in games ever, and then I started playing through it. I was like, that's why I never played through this. This isn't fun for me.
I don't like it.
And I was like, all right, well, I got to restart, and then I just never restarted it.
Yep. Nope. I've often mentioned that Inquisition was one of my favorite games of that era, the Xbox One era. So I've been excited about this for a long time. It was called Dragon Age Dreadwolf for a long time based on the ending of the previous game. And I think that's the only thing I didn't like about this was that the name change makes me think that they're really shifting away from making it I'm sure it's going to still be a direct sequel, but that's the way the story ended in Inquisition felt like, hey, we really have more to tell here. This trailer does none of that. It talks about nothing that happened in the previous game. The name change takes it away from it. That said, it looks fun to me. One of the things that I've always liked about Dragon Age, one of the things I like about 2 that I feel like a lot of people didn't, is that it felt like a heist game where you know, some movies that are parts of long series, like when we talk about genres and like Solo's kind of the heist movie of Star Wars, and the Ant-Man movies are kind of the heist movies of Marvel. Dragon Age has its sort of heist section, and that was 2. 2 was not quite as big and expansive as the first one, but it focused more on individual characters and stories and literally changing the world around you, stuff that Fable has always said it will do. It doesn't always do all that well. I'll say this, it was a little generic. Like, had I not recognized Varric, the dwarf with the big crossbow right out of the gate, I would not probably have known this was Dragon Age. But as a dyed-in-the-wool fanboy, yeah, I was excited immediately once I figured out what it was and where it was going. Apparently, they're doing a gameplay reveal on the 11th in a couple of days on Tuesday, so hopefully more then. But this was very much a let's introduce the characters that you're going to be dealing with to you. And honestly, it felt like, you remember how good the D&D movie was about a year and a half ago?
Yeah.
This felt like the video game for that. Like, you remember when we played that D&D video game that came out afterward and it was okay?
Yeah, oh God, what was it called? It doesn't matter. I don't even remember.
It wasn't very good. This is what that should have been. So in that way, I'm excited. And honestly, I mean, if it's not a big direct continuation of the other stuff, then great. Maybe more people will get interested in it and play it and enjoy it. Yeah, I don't know. I'm excited. It looks fun.
It's been long enough since Inquisition. It would probably be a better idea to make this a game that stands on its own 2 feet.
Yeah, maybe I'm just always going to be really disappointed that we're not going to get... Hopefully we are still getting a direct follow-up to that one, even if it's just like a separate quest or something. I don't know.
Yeah. Speaking of... Yeah. Hey. We got some DLC up next. Starfield Shattered Space. As the only person that still likes Starfield, I'll speak on this briefly. I did not see the trailer, so
they added a bunch of like little stuff. It looked like and a bunch of stuff with like how you set up your house and shit like that, as well as adding like some new areas and some new missions.
Yeah,
I want.
And there's new stuff coming today, so yeah, that's good.
I want Starfield to be so much better than it is. Like, I genuinely liked the game. I really did. When you first play it, it feels great. And then as you play along and you start to see the limitations and you start to experience some of the disappointment, it kind of creeps in on you. It's not all at once, because when you start, it feels great. It's amazing. Graphics are great. You make your own spaceships. You get to be kind of a cool, you know, kind of space pirate type thing. But then you start to see, you know, the way the travel system works and the lack of interactions with other characters that you're more used to in like other Bethesda games. And it really starts to...
How little your conversations seem to matter to a given situation. Like, when I keep like telling these people over and over again that I don't have a power, and then he's like, well, here, just take my ship, please.
Just
take my ship and leave.
That game had one of the fastest hey, let's get you to the storyline real quick moments I've ever had. You start off as like a miner, and within 5 minutes, they're like, okay, you're the savior. Here's your ship. Good luck. Whoa.
Yep. Like, just this random motherfucker's like, all right, here's your ship. And I'm like, I don't have a power. Leave me alone. And
he's just over sensing like, going, yeah. See you later, champ. I spent a lot of time customizing my ship and trying to just have fun with it. And there were cool things. You know, I was out in space once and I found that derelict ship with all the blood everywhere and stuff like that. It's like, wow, this is really cool. I wonder where this leads to. Nowhere. That's nowhere. The problem. It led nowhere. There was nothing. Yep. It was just...
It's still cool that you can stumble across stuff like that. Like, agreed. It would be nice if there was thing about it, but...
If there was some reward? Like, yeah.
Some reward, like a piece of lore, you know, anything, but...
A fucking jacket for all I care. Give me a shoe. Give me something.
My biggest problem with Starfield always was that, okay, this is Bethesda's big original IP, right? It's not Fallout. It's not the Elder Scrolls. It's not stuff that they've kind of... Well, I guess Elder Scrolls was them, right? No, that was ZeniMax. Anyway, point being, we didn't adapt this. We didn't pick it up from somebody else. We're doing this in-house, original, here we go. And it's just charmless.
Yeah.
There's not a thing about it that makes me give a shit about any of the people in it. The little factions they tried to set up and the individual characters, they all just feel like cheap imitations of what I've already done or what has already been done better and I've already played in better games like Fallout and Elder Scrolls. Right. The promise of this being their sort of Mass Effect of, oh, you get to leave planets and go into space was kind of not really fulfilled. And so it just... You can put all the mechanics in the world into it, but if this is a huge story-driven game, give me a story I give a damn about, or get out of my way. You know, the fact that it was on Game Pass and essentially free was the one saving grace for me for that game. I'll never forget the afternoon I was playing it randomly for like 3 hours straight, and Steven popped into the Discord and goes, "What are you doing?" And I went, "I don't know. I don't. I've been doing this for a while, and I don't know why, because I don't care about anything I'm doing. I'm just going through the motions."
I had a good time with it until I didn't, and I sometimes wonder if it wasn't on Game Pass, would I have been more inclined to play it? Like, if it was a, oh, I put money into this, so I'm going to enjoy it, god damn it. I don't know. Well,
I also heard that if you managed to get, like, you know, 30 hours into the game, it really, really picked up.
No. I was about 40 hours into it, and no, to be fair, it did pick up. Like, I had 3 or 4 different quests going on once. My biggest problem was... You make a space game, and we're not going to spend too much time on it, but you make a space game, and they tell you, well, you've got all of these places you can go. You can go to all these planets, all this cool stuff, but then you take away the ability to fly there directly. Like, you take out pretty much all the space travel and make it fast traveling to where you can appear in orbit of the planet. That's not the same.
Yeah.
And then you make the planets completely dead and uninteresting, except for, like, the one or two towns that are there. You might as well just have one planet and make it really fucking cool.
Yes,
you know,
I said it a million times in the lead up to it. That's what I was worried was going to happen. That's what Mass Effect managed to do really well multiple times over, and what I thought they were going to do here. And they said, no, we're not going to do that. And it's like, man, I get that you want to be your own thing, but this has been done better elsewhere.
Yeah.
Build on that.
That was the disappointment for me. But
yeah,
moving on to something that's not disappointing. And actually, I'm happy that
hopefully
again, I stuck with this thing since the beginning. To me, this and Star Wars Battlefront 2 are pins in my cap.
It's because the Atlantic City Expedition was very
meh.
That's the only reason I'm like, you know, disappointing would just be like, oh, it's not as good as I hoped it was going to be. I don't think it's going to be garbage or anything like
right.
that.
Right. Fallout 76 Skyline Valley is going live this week? Wednesday or Thursday?
Yeah, this Wednesday on June 12th.
And not only do we get the new season, but you also get a new area. And as was explained to me that I saw in there, this is not an expedition. This is a full-on new expansion area to the game.
Yep.
And that's awesome. It's in the Shenandoah area. I just got Tennessee Ernie Ford in my head. I can't get him out when I see the name Shenandoah. We get to go to Vault 63. You get to play as a ghoul next year, so unfortunately that's not right now. But really good video for Fallout 76, and I'm very happy that 76 is doing so well, especially after the Fallout TV show did so well. Whenever my friends are excited to play 76, I'm so happy, because I remember in that 2018 era, sitting alone in my little house that I built, watching the world. No one, Dalton played with me for like a day, and then he tapped out.
He was watching the world as he fell through his chair.
No, not there.
Into the center.
Well, yeah, it was there, actually. It was there.
I didn't play online then, or I might have, but I remember being very disappointed.
You were against
76
it.
Was,
yeah, I remember yeah, you well, being very against it.
Because, again, I wanted Fallout to be something I wanted to play, which was a single-player, story-driven, quest-based game. And eventually, I mean, it did basically become that.
But with friends.
But with friends, yeah. You could actually do stuff with other people. You didn't have to worry about, you know, other people that you didn't want messing with you to be around, so... Yeah, it has very much become, I would say it's become my favorite Fallout game, honestly.
I agree.
It was wild. But,
no, I 100% agree. I have so
definitely
many good
my
memories.
Favorite Fallout game.
What's that?
So it's definitely my favorite Fallout game.
Tanner got into it recently, too. Tanner's been big into it. I'm very happy. I'm sad that he missed us playing all the time because now he feels like we've abandoned him. We haven't.
Yeah.
No, we haven't.
Dude, like, I they keep floating back. I say they, like, I don't also do that.
Yes.
Like we will be back for a month or two at a time, and then a new game will come out. We'll drift over and we'll drift back.
Yeah, Fallout's one of those games that you come back to forever, like Call of Duty, like Red Dead Redemption 2.
Fallout 76 has been one of those games that like consistently for the past 4 years almost. We've come back to it just like if we get tired of playing one game or the other,
and it's just grown and grown and grown as a game, and I love it. It's so different from where it was before. And now, even the big, publications like IGN and places like that, they're not going to say it's an amazing game, but they give it positive reviews and say, yeah, it's good, go play it. So, I'm very happy Fallout 76 made a comeback. And like what was it, Star Wars Battlefront 2, what was that No Man's Sky? Games like that, which everyone kind of wrote off because they were bad, but they said, no, we're going to stick with it, make it better. And then there's Anthem, which was good. And then they just let it die.
And Spore.
I remember Spore.
That was another EA murder.
EA is a terrible company. Okay.
Yeah, they would have let Battlefront 2 die if Disney hadn't stepped in.
Yeah, the mouse showed up and was like, hey, you better make that fucking game better, bitch. Actual quote. All right. Moving on. Claire Obscure Expedition 33. Okay, moving past that.
No, fuck you. This looks awesome. Are you kidding me?
I saw nothing of this. I saw nothing. You gotta tell me about it.
You should watch the trailer.
Yeah, tell me about it.
Cool. Yeah. This is my, I don't want to say dark horse because, that makes it sound like it's not expected to do well. But this was the only game I think going in here that I knew absolutely nothing about that I could not be more excited about.
Because this is a brand new IP, right? Like this isn't something.
Yeah, this is a whole new thing. It looks very, Shannon, I think you'd like the look of the gameplay. It's very Western RPG, very Final Fantasy, but set in the West. There's a lot of kind of neo-noir sort of gothic type visualization, I guess, for lack of a better term. The story is very, we do what we can so that the ones behind us can do better. Very tough to tell where it's going from here. It's kind of a kind of gothic fantasy mix. But man, it looks awesome. It's turn-based. Like I said, it looks like a Final Fantasy. I keep saying Final Fantasy, but I think Persona is maybe a better representation of the fighting style.
Because it's a turn-based combat, but then they also have like a series of like quick time events that you add on to each of the moves.
Yeah,
and so you get to do other like cool shit, and it increases the amount of damage it does. So I guess instead of like a dice roll situation where it's like you're hit criticaled or missed, like you actually do a quick time event to determine if you critical or miss or anything along those lines. It also like the aesthetic just looks really, really cool. Like it's I don't know. It I don't really know how to describe it. It's pretty unique. Yeah, gothic fantasy kind of works, but it's also like a little Elden Ringy in a couple of places. Like it's neat looking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm really excited about this. I hope this turns out really well because God knows we could use some new IPs that do well and create new franchises and such.
Yes.
I guess I will have to
move on. That was good.
What's that?
I said, now we can move on.
Okay. Well, next we're moving
on to... Watch that trailer.
This one was called South of Midnight? Is that what it was?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is where I tuned in live.
Fully pass. Taking you down the street.
Yeah, this is where I tuned in live to the show, so I did get to see this one. This is when I started watching it live.
This is not the first time they've shown this game. It was shown last year, I'm almost positive.
I missed the first remember part them of it.
Because this is the first time we've seen gameplay.
Right, this is the first gameplay. They teased
it a while back, but...
My biggest concern about this game... It looks amazing. It looks incredible. Pretty. I love the Southern... Again, this is Southern Gothic storytelling. And I like the visual style, the art style. I like the idea behind the story and the look and the world. But the gameplay was maybe not the thing to show off here because it looks very generic.
There were a couple games on this show that made me go, what's the gameplay?
Right.
This looked like a 3D platformer. Nothing like... You know, super crazy. The flying around controls look kind of neat. Like, it looks neat, but it just looks like a very linear 3D platformer, which, like, that's fine. Those games can be extremely fun. But I don't know. We'll have to see more of it. I absolutely love the line, trifling ass mudcat. Like, that was hilarious to me. I don't know why.
it's very much, this is a, from the Destructoid article about it, I think they said it perfectly. The style is going to make or break this game because the gameplay is not going to be what's going to sell you on it. It's going to be the look and the story and the feel. So,
and this is also when the woke army started to come out.
Oh God. Damn. Day one Game Pass, by the way. Yeah. So that's another one that you can jump straight to. I don't think that Claire Obscure was. Maybe it was. I don't remember.
I can find out real quick. Hold on.
While he's doing that, we'll talk about one that absolutely is not coming to Game Pass, and I wish it would, because I'm already paying for Game Pass. It'd be nice not to have to pay for both. And that is the newest expansion for the World of Warcraft, The War Within.
Claire Obscure will be day one Game Pass.
There you Hell go. Yeah.
Yeah, I gotta say, so far everything that we've talked about is either, I mean, it's new content or it will be day one Game Pass.
No, Dragon Age will not.
What?
Dragon Age is not. I can confirm that one for you, because that's BioWare.
Yeah. That's one of the few companies that Xbox doesn't own yet. Blizzard hit us with War Within, and you don't have to say much about this. I know this isn't going to appeal to many of the console fans out there listening to the show, but Jesse and I have, as longtime World of Warcraft players, Hunter said, and I get it. Hunter said this, and I almost twitched my eye when he said, you know, we were talking about how great the cinematic was. He said the shame the game doesn't look that way. And my eye twitched because I was like, yeah, motherfucker, but...
It looks that way to me, damn it.
I'm super excited about this. And even if you don't play World of Warcraft, the trailer itself, going through all the trailers of the previous expansions, I literally teared up because I thought, man, I've been on this ride for like 15, 16 years now, since the first game, since the original. And 20 just shut up, Jesse. Shut up. Don't remind me of time. to see all of it though, back to back, boy. Oh, that it really got me right in the heart.
And the way they were doing that with, like, and I understand like how they were getting to, because this is supposed to be part one of like a trilogy of expansions that are ending Azeroth.
Yeah.
So we might, you know, finally get World of Warcraft 2 after that, or, you know, something along those lines. But like the way they were doing it though really had me thinking for a second that we were gonna get like, hey, World of Warcraft on Xbox.
Yeah, same.
Because they were just like, yeah, look at all this history and all this other stuff, and like now, you know, for the first time ever coming to console. But yep.
I feel like they could do it. They did it with Final Fantasy, and Final Fantasy is a very similar MMO. There are already add-ons out there and mods that will let you use Xbox controllers with the game. So it's not unheard of.
It is something they could do, but
it might be something
they might just not want to spend that dev time on it because it's, you know, a distinct possibility that they don't think this is going to last that much longer.
Oh, I don't know. As much money as they pull in, there's no way they're going to cancel this. Yeah,
I don't think they're going to cancel World of Warcraft. Like, they're just going to move on to a new title. Like, I could see them doing World of Warcraft 2.
There's no way in hell they won't do a Warcraft 2 when they finally kill World of Warcraft, because that's one of their cash cows. Even if Warcraft doesn't have the subscriber base that it had once upon a time, it's making hand over fist in money. You know, it's
really I close. also Just for the record, that's why I was a little shitty about it, because we were watching it and I was like, oh, fuck, they're going to put it on Xbox. And then I got to the end and it was just like, oh, no, this is a thing we've already announced that everyone knows coming.
Yeah,
I
was
like,
this was a nothing. Well, this was a nothing.
Then, you know.
Right. Well, stay tuned to me, Jesse, and Lindsay reviewing the shit out of it when it comes out. But until then, I wish Steven was here to talk about the next one, because this one was pretty much just for him. Metal Gear Solid. Unless you guys play Metal Gear. I'm not a big Metal Gear fan, but.
No, man, weirdly. You know, you look at a game like that and you look at the way that I play games and you go, well, surely he does.
That's
and
just
I,
meant
for
you.
For whatever reason, I just missed the Metal Gear boat completely. And so I've never. I owned one of the collections on PS3 that was like one of the previous PS2 collections. Didn't play it one time. Ended up selling it for more than I bought it for. I don't know.
The MGS collection was going for big money for some reason.
I've never been a fan of Metal Gear.
They look great. They look awesome, but I just, yeah. If this is
Metal Gear,
and I want to say this might have been coming to Game Pass, weirdly.
That would be odd, because it's a remake.
Surprising.
It's a remake of Snake Eater, Metal Gear Solid
3. If it's coming to Game Pass, I'll say it here and now. I'll give it a shot. Like,
Steven,
I'll absolutely.
Steven will definitely give it a shot.
Buffering through the video, does not seem to be.
Yeah,
that makes sense. I didn't figure it was, but it looks great. I mean, visually, it looks awesome, and I know
MGS3 is super popular. Like, that one's always been one
right.
of the.
Do you guys remember when Metal Gear for 2 and 3 specifically, where they had the multiple versions of it, and then people would come in and ask you for, you guys have Metal Gear 2? Well, do you mean Metal Gear 2 or Sons of Liberty? Do you have Metal Gear 3? Well, do you mean? And there was one that was like Substance or Sustenance.
Subsistence.
Oh
yeah,
my
that
god,
was
that was so dumb. That got so weird. All three of us used to work at GameStop, what an annoying fucking thing that was.
You got out before Call of Duty got out of hand.
Oh my god.
Well, out is a funny way to put
systems
it.
Systems in general. You got Xbox. Well, which one do you want? An Xbox Series X or a Series S or a 1X or a 1?
Yeah, no, I am thrilled that I don't work in video game retail with this shit going right now, especially when Xbox One hit. Okay, I was working at GameStop when Xbox One hit, but like I left the year that the Xbox One came out, so I didn't have to deal with it that much. And I also, you know, didn't have to deal with it much at Gaming Grounds, where they actually do carry the original Xbox.
Yeah,
trying to explain to an elderly woman that there's a difference between the original Xbox and an Xbox One.
Yeah, that's where it gets annoying. When people come in and say, and they never did it until the Xbox One got announced. No one ever said Xbox One. They just said Xbox. Then they started coming in and going, do you have an Xbox One? Well, do you mean the Xbox One or the original Xbox? It's kind of like when they say, do you guys have
any... Let me get that 2K.
Yeah, well...
Wrestling, hockey, basketball.
There were so many times that a certain ethnic group would come in and ask for 2K. And because I didn't want to feel racist, I would say wrestling, and it was never wrestling. But I didn't want that on my soul.
I just sold the basketball. Oh, man. I knew that's what they wanted.
Moving on. Sea of Thieves Season 13, you can become a villain. I thought you already were the villain.
Yeah, I don't really understand. What do you mean you can become the villain? What does that mean?
You're already a fucking pirate. Yeah.
Right. I'm very confused. I'll say what I said in the group chat, which is I look forward to going back to that game for a week and then not playing it again for months.
It was it's so much fun to dick around on, but then that gets old, man. You got to give me more than that.
So fast. It's so much fun for several days, and then you go you have the Hannibal moment of, what am I doing? Yeah.
And I really don't understand the villain thing, because...
No, it's very confusing.
The point of the game is that you create your own stories, basically. You could be the good guy, you could be the bad guy. You could be the villain. You hunt down other players, you take their stuff.
Yes.
How far are you taking this? Do we start sacrificing them to demons, or what's going on here?
By the look of the ship, like, that's not outside the realm of possibility.
It's very demonic looking, yeah. Yeah. Anyway.
Let's go ahead and move on.
This game
looks fucking cool as shit.
Flintlock, The Siege of Dawn.
All right, before you say anything else, the worst title of the entire thing.
It sounds like a
terrible fucking title.
This title sounds like, I don't know, I know Hunter's a big movie buff. I'm not sure if Jesse's aware of The Asylum. This sounds like if The Asylum made a game based on another game with a better title. And they called it Flintlock, The Siege of Dawn.
You know what bothered me so much was the last lines in the trailer before they revealed the title, in like a big smash cut, you know, black and white thing, it said, Kill All Gods. And I went, that's a fucking title. Dope name. And yeah. Sarah goes, oh, that sounds cool as shit. And then it says, Flintlock, The Siege of Dawn. And we both went, what?
Yeah, Kill All Gods like would have been a way better fucking...
That would have been awesome. This sounds like what a edgy 10th grader would name their narrative to end the first unit of study over plot.
And all the characters in their fanfic are named after their friends.
the game looks nice, and it's on Game Pass. So it's a Souls Lite, I think they called it. So not like full on Souls, but a little easier maybe.
I like that in the group chat, Hunter's comment on it. It looks like Assassin's Creed, but interesting.
I feel bad. Tanner's gonna wake up for that.
Man, because I was sitting there thinking, like, oh, this looks like kind of like Assassin's Creed, but a little bit more action. And like, I saw, because like I was playing a game in one window, I had like the showcase going at the top half, and I had the chat scrolling on the bottom half of my screen. And I saw that, I was like, ah.
admittedly, coming from somebody who did like Assassin's Creed for a long time, but I just, the gameplay looked like it. And then, slowly but surely it devolved into, oh, nope, there's a fox, and there's some other things, and that ain't that.
Stuff. It's Souls-like. It's a much more fast-paced looking Souls-like.
Very stylish looking.
Very stylish.
Yeah. Up next, Age of Mythology Retold.
If you've ever played Age of Mythology, it was super fun RTS back in the day.
Yeah, my problem is I don't know if I can play it now, because I tried to play the new Age of Empires games, and they're still good, but I don't know if I have the time and patience to play an RTS in the year of our Lord 2024.
Yeah, that's one of those games that, like, I can't get into RTSs enough to do more than just, like, my ideal fun time with an RTS these days is getting in there with a few friends and comp stomping.
Right.
Like, just set the bots to fucking, like, easy or maybe normal and just destroy them.
Because I think Pat still plays, you know, like, StarCraft and stuff.
Occasionally. Seriously.
Yeah.
No, he hasn't played, like, hardcore in a while, because he used to be fucking, like, legitimately, he was in Masters ranking.
Yeah. Him and Ed.
Like, which is... Both yeah, that's one step down from, you know, professional.
Right.
But yeah, he never made that last step, and then he kind of like backed away from it for a little while because it was not. I feel like he got extra angry at that one.
Well, I know Bob's very excited about this because Bob is a big Age of Mythology fan. I was never an Age of Mythology fan. I thought it was fine. I preferred Age of Empires. I will try this out when it comes out, though, because I didn't get to play the original very much. Maybe I'll like it more. It looks like a big visual upgrade, but it still looks very cartoony. So I don't know how I'm going to feel about that. But it looks fun. It looks fun. And I would love to talk about it more. But if we talk about it more, that's going to stop me from talking more about the next game, which... We started watching this trailer, and this is about when I was really heavy into the woke jokes, which is a joke, by the way. I was talking about my frustration with every character being a strong woman, and that is a joke, obviously. And then this pops up, and I see the hair, and as soon as I see her land and she starts talking about the mission, and I see the hairstyle, I immediately go, no, that's not that. And then the more they talk and the more they walk through the little trailer, and then I see Carrington. And I'm like, no fucking way. And I said to the chat, is that Perfect Dark? And sure as shit, we're getting a new Perfect Dark game, and it looks awesome.
It looks fucking amazing. I like the Kotaku article.
Woo, Perfect Dark is coming back, and it looks fucking sick.
Looks fucking sick. It also looks like it really does. I feel like this is a prequel, right? Because this is where she gets indoctrinated into the Carrington Institute, I'm assuming.
Carrington. Yeah. 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 It took me a minute to get back to that whole story. Because, man, that 360 game, as you said, was a game on the Xbox 360.
It was released.
But boy, the N64 game. So God, it was amazing.
I loved that game so much.
For what everybody remembers they loved about GoldenEye, it was GoldenEye, but better. Yeah. The only thing it didn't have was the James Bond license. That's it.
But instead, you had Joanna Dark, who was fucking amazing. Joanna Dark was cool
as hell. And it had Grays.
Yes.
You could play as a Gray.
One was named Elvis.
He was. He had a little shirt.
You had my favorite gun in the game, which was a laptop that you threw the laptop down and turned into a fucking turret.
Yes.
Such a good game. I love that.
No, I'm really excited about this. That, like, everybody's always super hyped about like how much they love James Bond back in the day, and it was great. Like, GoldenEye was awesome. But then, like, that kind of started a trend. There were, like, six other games that came out that played better.
Yeah. Including Perfect Dark.
Made by Rare. Including Perfect Dark, 100%. Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm very, very excited about this. I'm so happy to step back into the world of Joanna Dark. What was her sister's name? This is a weird question. I keep wanting to say Velvet, but it wasn't Velvet Dark, was it? Because you can play... So if you played the original Perfect Dark, she was in it.
It was Velvet.
Was it Velvet?
Yep.
Wow. Surprised I remembered that.
To be fair, it says she is presumably Joanna's sister.
Yeah. She's blonde,
no
right?
No guarantee.
If I remember correctly.
Case. Yeah, I got the picture here.
Let me see. Real quick.
Oh,
well, I looked and it was just Adler. I'm like, well, that ain't her.
No, I haven't. Well, okay. That's not what I wanted, but it's fine. It'll give you enough of a look at it to get an idea. This was the simulant buddy that would show up, basically.
Yep, Velvet. Yep. That looks like that's from the remake that they did on Xbox, which was really, really good, too, by the way.
Yeah, it's much cleaner.
So, yeah, Perfect Dark. I'm fucking... This might be the one... Other than Warcraft and Microsoft Flight Simulator, this might be the one I was most excited for in this whole thing.
It looks awesome.
I was pretty fucking hyped for what we're about to talk about.
What's that, Jesse? Well, tell me.
We got the official announcement for the first expansion to Diablo 4.
And boy, did that trailer look brutal.
Yeah, the trailers for this game look fucking amazing. Like, as we were watching, Sarah goes, "What the hell am I looking at?"
Like every cinematic,
it's photorealistic almost, man.
Yeah, every cinematic for Diablo 4 has been in fucking incredible. I mean, like, Blizzard has always been great
at
cinematic.
Yeah,
and like, you know, like we were talking about before, Diablo 4 is just one of those games where like the game also looks like the cinematic because it is very, very pretty. It's going through a renaissance right now. Diablo 4 is the best it's ever been at the moment.
It's true.
It's a shame that there are way too many games right now that I desperately want to play.
Yeah.
But, Diablo 4 looks great. This cinematic looked incredible because they gave us the opening cinematic for the expansion. And it's picking fucking up right cool. where the other story left off because, I mean, minor spoilers, I guess, for people. Like, we have a character that we gave Mephisto's Soul Stone to. And anybody that knows anything about Diablo lore knows that can only end poorly.
I think she's going to get a happy ending.
I think it's going to be fine. Yeah.
I think everything's going to be fine. Based on that trailer.
Hey, am I going to have to pay for this?
Yes.
DLC.
Mm. Yeah, this is an expansion. I mean, it might be Game Pass. Like,
yeah.
I don't know.
I feel like they're going to charge for it. Like, I do.
That's unfortunate.
Yeah.
I'm it's not saying Blizzard. I won't buy it, but... You know
what was the new class?
I don't know.
Spirit class,
Spirit Walker, Spirit,
Spirit something. Born, the Spirit apex born. Predator of the jungle, poised to strike both with styles and mystical synergies that could only be awakened deep beneath the jungle canopy with an entirely new class to the iconic Diablo series. It looks like it's a bit of a retuned Witch Doctor kind of a theme on that. With like they also added, you know, a melee option that you can lean into that route if you want.
So as I described earlier, not paladin.
Not is, paladin. Is what, or crusader.
For a
crusader. Shannon and I were hoping for.
For an expansion I am so excited about, what a class that I don't give a shit about.
Yeah, that is.
Well, look who's playing fun. Destiny 2, Steven, you bastard. All right, we got a lot more games. We got to keep it going here. Fable, they announced a new Fable. Whoa,
that they did
again. They did it again. Boy, I sure hope this one comes out.
I have full confidence that this one is going to actually release.
Oh boy, I hope so. Peter Molyneux somewhere.
this scared me because I've always wanted to love Fable. I didn't like the first one because, again, you were forced to play as this specific character. Fable 2, I thought, was probably the best of them, if I remember correctly.
I love Fable 2. I mean, I also love Fable 3. I think Fable 3 was the first one where you actually got to create a character, if I remember correctly.
And the multiplayer was weird but interesting. The thing that worries me about this Fable is, and I made a joke about this in the chat about I hope we don't have to play as this specific girl. And this isn't a man, a boy, girl thing. I hate games where they force you, like especially fantasy games. I hate games where they force you to play as
RPGs.
Yeah, a specific character. I want to make my own character. I want to be involved with it. So I hope that that happens, because if that happens, and they've had so much time between the, you know what the last Fable was?
Fable 3
VR one, the remake,
the Kinect one. Fable Endless Journey or whatever it was.
Oh, yeah, but it wasn't even a Fable game. It was just a game they slapped Fable on top of.
You basically rode in a cart and threw magic to the sides as you went.
Yeah, that was just, it was just a shitty rail shooter they like for VR that they slapped the Fable name on.
So if they
not even VR. Kinect. No, motion. Kinect.
Yeah. If they do Fable right, and they add in all the like the options and how everything influences the world and the story, I could be really behind this game. But it remains to see. Oh, there's a Shelby. It remains to be seen whether or not they do that. Well, let's move on. I know I feel weird moving on from Fable like that, because that is a big announcement. But like Hunter said, Peter Molyneux. Oh,
he's not even involved with stuff anymore, right?
Hopefully not.
I don't know, is he?
I don't know.
I feel like I hear 14 things about Fable every couple of years, and then nothing ever happens. So it's hard to get excited about it, man.
I do hope that this works out, because I love the Fable games, Fable 1, 2, and 3. Fable 3 was my least favorite, just because of how it ended. It was a
weird
story.
Yeah, it was weird. I think Fable 3, though, was the one where Bob married a ghost, and then he got an STD from her.
God damn it.
Really Fable weird 3, story.
Like the problem Fable 3 had was, like, after you beat the main story, you then had to do this, like, super grindy thing to actually get the best ending. Because
it's for the
like,
money, right?
Because you have to have, like, so much money and so many resources to get the best ending. And it's like, oh, so I've now beaten the game, but now I have to grind for hundreds of hours because I haven't been stockpiling gold and like following all these strategies to get it done.
I simply will not.
No.
That soured me on the game quite a bit. Grapes. Fable 1 and 2 were fantastic. I loved those games.
Well, Jesse, what about Fragpunk, which seems to be a card-based shooter?
I'm good. No thanks.
Yeah, like, same. The style looked kind of cool, but, like, yeah, no, it's nothing I'm interested in trying.
Tanner, you got something to say about that one?
For the same, Hunter stole my line.
Oh, I'm good. All right, here's a game for Sarah and Shelby, specifically, Winterboro.
Bullshit, I'm playing this, too. This looks adorable. Oh, my God, this game looks adorable.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. You could be a little mouse.
That's an adorable mouse.
You can build up your little tree stump.
Real funny. Like in the trailer, you know, the owl comes in and just like, you know, grabs the kid in the trailer. And then Shelby's like, no, owl. And then like I looked down and she was basically reading Hunter's message in the unknowingly.
No owl.
That looks like that's going to be a good one. Yeah.
That looks very fun. Sarah immediately goes, no Switch though? And I was like, well, number one, you're not going to hear about that today. And number two, G-Cloud. And she goes, oh, yeah, never mind. That's good. It's coming to Game Pass. I can play it in bed. That's really all I need to know.
Up next, a game that looks like it would make a fantastic film. Mixtape. I don't know what this is.
I have no idea. It looks like a great movie. I would totally watch this movie. I have no idea what the fuck is happening in this
I don't
movie.
Know where the gameplay is. That's what I want to know. Where is the gameplay? Is it the skateboarding?
Is it
the flying?
What is it?
Like what? Like I'm wondering if this is just another one of those like What Remains of Edith Finch. Like it's mostly an interactive movie.
Yeah.
Like you kind of play through.
And that's cool. I mean, you know.
Yeah, like I'm fine with that. Like What Remains of Edith Finch was an incredible game. I highly recommend everybody try it out. You can knock it out in like 3 hours. Very, very fun game.
You interviewed the one of the guys from it. Once upon a time.
Ian Dallas, he's the creator of the game.
Right.
That was a very fun game, and this could be that too. I don't know. We got no information on this.
No gameplay.
This is one of those ones I do wish that we had gotten a guy that on the stage awkwardly talking about it for a second.
Yeah.
Yeah, here's what you're gonna do in this game. Otherwise, what's gonna happen.
You can't convince me this is just QuickTime Event, the game. But we'll see what happens. Music sounds great. Yeah. Graphics are incredible. Speaking of graphics being incredible, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but Microsoft Flight Simulator 2024. Oh, be still my heart. This is one of my favorite games ever, Microsoft Flight Simulator. It's given me the ability to fly anywhere in the world, and because the graphics are so good and it uses real data from like Google, You can literally, I'm not kidding, you can go anywhere. If you download Microsoft Flight Simulator, you can fly anywhere in the world, and it's all mapped out. It looks amazing. This one seems like it adds a bunch of new jobs. So instead of just flying from airport to airport, there are different missions and careers you can follow, which looks cool. And
Red Bull races.
Yeah. Yeah. And there was a part where you can get out and take pictures. Like, if they give you the ability to get out of the fucking plane and actually walk around too, oh my God, this, I will never leave this game. We'll see what happens. That's coming out later this year. Very excited about that.
A lot of time in his VR headset playing this game.
He's going to be very busy on my wedding anniversary. That's yeah. The day it comes out. November 19th.
You know what? Congrats, but Elder's crying.
I don't know. Nothing. He had nothing for that.
ESO Gold Road, which is already out. It looks fun. We've had some great times with ESO, but it's kind of more of the same. What a weird song pick for that, though.
It was
the Marco Stunt's theme music. It was very strange.
Yeah, We Belong was a choice. It was definitely a choice.
Two Marco Stunt references. This
was another. This to me was just like the Warcraft thing. It was a very big nothing burger. Like,
yeah, it was cool.
We're getting an announcement for a thing we've already known about, Gold Road.
And Gold Road's already out. At least Warcraft's still coming out.
No. June 18th. Yeah.
Yeah, June 18th is when it's
really.
Yeah, the next thing comes out on June 18th.
I've been seeing people talking about it already. Is it not out yet?
Mm-mm. Unless it's something else, but yeah, something is coming out on. Basically, the big announcement today was all the DLC
came out June 3rd.
Well, then what the fuck is coming out June 18th?
What the fuck is coming out June 18th? Yeah.
Because yeah, this article says ahead of its launch date on June 18th, 2024.
Homie, I'm looking at it right now. Elder Scrolls Online, Gold Road, June 18th, 2024.
Yeah.
I just looked it up and it said it released was released on June 3rd, 2024.
I wonder if there was some way you could get early access to it, maybe?
I mean, this is this is directly from the end of the video.
Yeah.
Bam, right there.
I don't want this to be the thing that I die on, the hill that I die on. But I am gonna die on it, so I'm still looking it up.
There is already a review out for it, apparently.
Yeah, because somebody was complaining. Yeah, no, release date, June 3rd. I'm looking on Steam right now.
Well then what the hell is coming out on June
18th? I don't know. I'm very fucking confused now.
Hold up, I got you. I got you, baby bird. Don't worry.
Okay.
All right. So June 18th, the game releases for Xbox and PlayStation. June 3rd, it released on Epic, Steam, and PC.
There it is. That makes more sense.
So that's why it was in the thing today, too. Yeah, yep. that's why they made a big point of it today.
Speaking of things we're confused about, Life is Strange, Double Exposure. Ethan explained it to us, thank God.
Yeah, because I said it, and I borrowed it from the meme. I don't understand why Life is Strange is a big deal, and at this point, I'm too afraid to ask.
Because I know, apparently Life is Strange is a fucking incredible
series.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Like 10 out of 10, incredible fucking game. One of the best stories ever told.
But it's also, isn't it another just like quick time event, the game? Like you just press a button and keep it moving type of thing?
Yes. Yeah, it's that storytelling kind of like interactive movie basically kind of thing.
So, I mean, again, on Game Pass, down for it. Like that's great. Man. Like I can totally, I just can't bring myself to pay for something like that.
There was a game that came out for Game Pass. It was one of the first Xbox Series X games. I don't remember what it was called now, but it was, you were like a detective or something, and you had to basically go through both our world and like the other side, the supernatural world. You switch back and forth between them. And I remember thinking it was a cool game. I played it briefly and I never touched it again. I wish I knew what it was because it kind of reminds me of that.
And are you talking about Benedict Fox?
No.
I played that a little bit at the store once. Yeah,
no, this it was year. One word, if I remember correctly. And
I said yeah, like yeah, no, yeah,
yeah, that was it. We're getting down to the end here. There's a couple of Know Nothing games on there, but before we get to that, Hunter, this one I know you're excited about. Indiana Jones and the Great Circle.
Ba-ba-da-da.
Shelby is also super excited about this
shit.
Game.
Sarah is too, because it's first person, and most of what she likes playing is first person like that. She had no idea that it was going to be a first person game. No, this looks great, and I love that what they showed us was just a lot of in-game engine, cinematic type stuff. We've seen the gameplay a little bit here and there, the little snap cuts from different areas, but it looks like a true, like, solid indie adventure. Indiana Jones games are very hit and miss. There are some that are, like, super revered, some of the older games, and I honestly, at this point, the names blend together, so I can't remember and tell you off the top of my head which ones are good and which ones aren't, but some of them are great, some of them are awful, and it has been a long time since we've had a great one. Really, the last thing we got were the last couple LEGO games, and they were fun, but like any LEGO game, they are what they are. You play it, you run around, you beat up on the bad guys, and you do your thing. This is that, but it's like, it very much looks like a playable movie, and that's exactly what I want at this point. Harrison Ford, I think we found out past the end of the last one, is he's got to be done. There's no way to keep making the movies with him, so
right.
Do the games. And it looks incredible. Again, it looks like a movie set as a game that you can actually play through, so I'm really excited about that.
I'm assuming Harrison Ford is not doing the voice, though, right?
He is not. No, I can't remember who it is.
Boy, they got a good dude for it.
Yeah. Oh, God. I don't... For a second, I was going to say it was the guy who was at Cape Comic-Con last year. I don't think it is. Ross Marquand. I don't think it's him. But it's a very good impressionist who's playing.
Everything right now, though.
Yeah,
that yeah, I mean, yeah, he's so busy with Marvel, I was going to say. And in the great circle, like, I don't know, Troy Baker. I should have guessed. Troy Baker.
He's in everything. Man. Yeah.
It's either Troy Baker or what's his name, Nathan.
No. Or Nathan.
The guy who plays Nathan Drake. What's his name?
That's Troy Nolan Baker.
North. No, it's Nolan, isn't it?
Nolan North.
Nolan North. That's what I was trying to think of. Yeah, that's the name I was trying to come up with.
I still can't figure out the name of the game I was talking about. Go ahead, Tanner.
He plays Desmond in Assassin's Creed.
Yeah, well, it's funny you mention that, Tanner, because Assassin's Creed is coming up in a few. But yeah, Indiana Jones and the Great Circle looks really good. I'm very excited about it.
This is an hour and a half show, and we're not even close to done.
We're almost done, because the next few games, we can just breeze on by. Mecha Break. It's a mech game. Hunter called it Nausea the Experience. I agree with that.
Too fast.
This game had shit flying everywhere. I want a good mech game so bad. I'll definitely try it, but I don't think it's gonna keep me. Wu-Tang Fallen Feathers.
It's for kids. It's for the kids. It's for the children.
There's nothing about this that really. It looked fine.
I like Kotaku's explanation. A gentle Bloodborne. I mean, yeah. It's again Game Pass. Sure, I'll give it a shot, but it doesn't look like anything. Game Pass? I think so.
Should be. They all are.
Not all of them are saying that at the end of the trailer.
Wu Chang is Game Pass. Yep.
Yeah. And then we had Avowed, which, sure.
Boy, this looked like the most generic shit I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah. Like, I really, really like that thumbnail for it. Like, that looks fucking
cool.
That looks better than the game did.
Like, watching the gameplay was absolutely just like, oh, this is somebody was like somebody asked AI to generate a game.
An Elder Scrolls game?
Yeah.
It's an Obsidian game. It just looks like.
Well, if it's Obsidian, I'll at least give it. I'll wait because Obsidian makes great games.
Won't be ready to go when it first comes out.
And I mean it's going to Game Pass, and I'm sure you know maybe the story is going to hold it together. But yeah, gameplay wise, it just looked extremely generic. Some of the scenes look kind of cool, but yeah, nothing groundbreaking. Yeah.
Then we had Adam Fall.
Also, groundbreaking.
Looked interesting.
Again, it looks interesting, but like across the two articles, they're both like, it's hard to describe this. Like, it's kind of post-apocalyptic. There are some weird things that live underground. Apparently, Destructoid Zoe Hanley said, it looks like absolutely everything.
Yeah.
Because it's just... I don't even know how to describe this game. I really don't.
You got some Fallout vibes. You got some Elder Scrolls vibes, maybe. You got some State of Decay vibes. Like it looks creepy. Interesting.
In a cool way.
It's a maybe. All right, Tanner, you're up. Assassin's Creed Shadows. What do you got?
Oh, my God. This game looks fucking amazing. We're going back to original, like, Assassin's Creed just style, and oh my god, the game looks beautiful.
I think it looks really good. I'm actually
very violent.
I'm very intrigued by this game because I did not know that the Black Samurai was a real thing. This was something new to me. So I looked up the history of it, and it's a very interesting history for this Black Samurai.
Shannon, that's impossible. There were no black men. There's no way that there was a Black Samurai.
Oh, we're not talking about dragons and Elder Scrolls Online, Jesse. We're talking about real history here.
Jesse, you got to give him this one, because if not, then it's that woman, and then it's woke for him, and he can't do that.
Is our African American gentleman not woke enough? Yeah, they should have called this Assassin's Creed Double Woke.
Because that was the joke I was making. Like, so many people were talking about, like, no, there were a Black Samurai. These fucking woke motherfuckers. Like, this is so fucking stupid.
Yeah, and that's what I would. Well, I wouldn't have said that obviously because I'm not a knuckle dragging idiot. But I didn't know that there was this guy, Yasuke, who was a real samurai. He apparently was like sold into slavery. He ended up with Oda Nobunaga and became one of his people, one of his samurai. And it's an incredible story. I read through all of it after this game was announced. So this game kind of introduced me to that. It's very cool that they put him in this. So I'm very curious to see how this game goes. I've never been a big Assassin's Creed fan. I think it's a good game series, and I've played one or two of them. But I'm really curious about this one. And Tander, you were very disappointed in Mirage, right? So is this kind of going to bring you back to the heart of it?
I think it can, just because it's an interesting story that I am into. And we'll see. My harshest judgment for Mirage came from the fact that there was no modern day. I recognize that I'm in the minority of that, which is fine. Whatever. I like the modern day story of Assassin's Creed.
I've always wondered why they've never just made a full on modern one.
It wouldn't work. I've thought about that myself, and it just wouldn't work.
I think they had it. It was called Watch Dog Legions.
Basically,
hey, here's another. The next one, I called it during the trailer. I didn't realize that. I thought there was no way in hell they were going to bring out another Stalker game. But sure enough, Stalker 2 is coming out. The original Stalker game came out in... How long ago was this?
It's been a minute.
It was a while, man.
It's been a while.
Yeah.
Yeah, the original Stalker came out in 2007.
Holy shit. Really striking
why the iron's hot on that one. I was very surprised it was a Stalker game, but Stalker is based around Chernobyl, which if you are history buffs or if you know anything at all, you'll know Chernobyl was a very famous disaster that is still, I think, too irradiated today to still go there. Like, you have to be in and out. Yeah, you have to be in and out within specific time periods. So I'm kind of excited about this game. That looks cool. The trailer really didn't do much for me. It looked good, but I'll be honest, it didn't sell me, but I will check it out when it comes out. Especially if it's on Game Pass, I can see myself doing that. Xbox Series X, we're getting a new white one and we're getting an all digital one. Oh boy. Get your dicks out. This one's exciting.
That's the same thing.
Oh, the white one is
the white one is the digital one.
I thought we were going to get a white one, like for digital and for a CD. Okay.
Yeah, there's not a white Series X.
The all digital Xbox Series X is white, and then they're doing a special edition Series
Galaxy
X
Black.
That's the Galaxy Black, yeah.
Which,
and
like,
it's got a 2 terabyte hard drive.
Yeah, the Galaxy Black one, like, that's something that could have been really interesting to Shelby. Which, I mean, she'll still think it looks cool because of how her color blindness works. But yeah, it was a weird choice making it like green, with like all the stars are green. And the little stars on the controller are green.
Yeah.
That was a choice.
It's all right.
I will never support an all-digital gaming world. Not just because it hurts my personal bank account, but because I think it's just a mistake to make everything digital. You have very little control over the things you purchase. So therefore, do you actually own them?
We have, like, it's been made abundantly clear that we do not own our digital purchases.
Right.
Right.
You're just renting the license, basically.
Yep. Oof. Yeah, that has been made very clear over the last like 5 and 6 years that we have no ownership of anything we buy digitally.
All right. Well, that's it. I think that was it, right? Was there anything else?
Well, they did have one more little announcement.
Just a small one.
They got through just in after there. They talked about the Xboxes. They had one little thing they wanted to talk about.
I didn't see it, Hunter. What was it? I'm not aware.
Well, you want to talk about rip and tear until the work is done. I have fucking loved Gears of War ever since it was in its infancy. One of the first things I actually did bother to play online was the original, and then the follow-up. Right before we all started playing Call of Duty together, the last Gears of War that came out before that, I played a little online just because I had, like, you know, free trials and shit. I am very excited that there is a new Gears of War coming down the pipeline and that hopefully we will be playing together. This is going to be Game Pass. This is going to be a prequel. So it's, if you watch the trailer, you're going to see a very young version of Marcus and Dom from the originals. It's called E-Day. I know Asa mentioned that Judgment was technically a prequel as well. As I recall, Judgment happens like right before the first game. This looks like it happens like, well, literally the day that the war starts. I mean, E-Day was the day, the emergence day, the day the locusts came up from underground. And so it's been a long fucking time since I've A, played Gears of War, and B, been excited about it. I know this is a ways away. If I remember correctly, it's 2025. Looks like it's going to be some time out. But man, it looks very, very, oh no, they didn't even give a release date. So who knows how long it's going to be. But it looks awesome. I'm very excited about it, especially as much as we play online together now. I could have that be my Call of Duty substitute for some time, for sure.
I'm just a little sad that I won't be able to play as, Linda Hamilton's character from the Terminator in it. Because she was in the last game. No, she was in the last game. They added her.
And, I know. Yeah. So was Batista. I played as Batista.
Batista.
I think Xavier Woods got added at one point, if I remember correctly.
I bought the first Gears of War on a whim. Like, we were at Best Buy, and I had never heard of it. Like, literally, I wasn't really big into like reading about upcoming games. I'm still not usually, but I saw Gears of War when it came out at Best Buy, and I think it was with Lindsay, and I was like, you know what, I'm going to buy this. This kind of looks interesting, and I loved it. And then Gears of War 2 was even better. And then to me, Gears of War 3 was even better. Gears of War 3,
I think thought, that's where it peaked.
Yeah, that was my absolute, the horde mode in that game was just phenomenal. So much fun. Judgment was okay. It wasn't bad. And then I honestly wasn't a huge fan of 4 or 5. I thought they were okay.
But they were fine. 4 or 5. I played quite a bit of the original trilogy with my then roommate Trevor Camp.
Yeah.
Like, we were always looking for, you know, couch co-op games that we could play together.
Yeah.
And yeah, Gears of War was a great one. Like, yes. That was a lot of fun.
Bob and I played it couch co-op through the entire, I think, 1 and 2. It was just really good. Really fun. And I'm so excited that they're bringing out a new one. And I love the fact that it's a prequel. I love prequels. I love seeing when shit goes down.
Especially this one, because that's like the only thing we've never seen.
Right.
Is exactly what happened the day that it just went to
Emergence Day. Yeah.
Yeah.
I watched, not too long ago, I watched The World of Worlds again with Tom Cruise. I like that movie. And I realized that what I really love about it is all of the stuff before the aliens invade and then seeing it happen. That transition of peaceful life to, you know, complete chaos, that is very interesting to me. It's the only reason I might go see the new. What's that movie with the monsters you have to be quiet about? What's the name of that?
Quiet Place.
I might go see the new one is because it's a prequel. It takes place when it all goes down. So I'm very excited about this. And not only that, but just, man, this Xbox showcase as a whole, this might be the best showcase I've ever seen. Like,
it was stacked.
Yeah.
It was a stacked showcase.
Pound for pound, this thing was absolutely incredible. It really did have something for everybody. So I am very excited for Xbox right now. I'd like to. I joked with Asa earlier. We were texting back and forth, and I said, you know, he said he doesn't have a lot of faith in Xbox. He wants to, but he's worried. And I said, well, if they can pull it off, if they can actually pull this off and release these games on time for everybody, PlayStation will still be in the lead. But I'll be very excited because these games looked incredible. I cannot wait to play a lot of these. Some in 2024, some in 2025. But that's going to do it for us. We want to know what you're excited about, though. Which game did you think looked incredible? Hit us up on our socials or through email or call me. You can stop by the store. You can stop by my house. I really don't care. I live a solitary life. thank you guys for tuning in for this very special episode of Nerdish. Anthony Anderson never came on.
He's running late. He'll
get here sometime. But what do we got up for the rest of the week, though? We got more stuff, right?
Oh, God, we're going to be busy. So, because I was gone last week, we missed the first episode for the month of Extras and Epilogues for, as we kick off wet, hot E&E summer, Blockbuster June. And so we're doing a special episode tomorrow. We're going to knock out Jurassic Park, one of my all-time favorite movies, one of Shannon's all-time favorite movies, not to give too much away in advance, but we'll talk about that tomorrow. And then on Tuesday, Plays is back. We got a new episode coming up of our Fallout adventure, the showdown at Skull Canyon. It's been a while since we've done that as well, but a couple of weeks, so we'll jump back in there. Wednesday, back to our regularly scheduled programming, another E&E. We got several movies to cover this month, and we haven't decided yet what it will be at that time. Will it be Top Gun? Will it be Jaws? Will it be Titanic? We'll have to, find out. And then Thursday, an all new After Dark with a list this time instead of just you guys jerking each other's dicks around and talking about how much you love each other.
I thought it was sweet.
It was. It very much was. It was the first thing I listened to when I got on the plane because my name was in the title and I'm an egomaniac. So.
And I got an all-time.
You changed the title too. It just said Hunterless at one point, and then it changed to what is it now?
It's a Thursday Random Sunday or Hunterless on Broadway. Because all right, on
Broadway Street.
Yeah. So to be fair, when I finished recording the show and I posted it, I was kind of drunk. And I don't even remember what I named it. So
I could tell.
Yeah.
It was just Hunterless. It said Podzilla After Dark Hunterless.
So I wanted to put something a little bit more in there and give it a little bit more meat on the bones there. And when you, Jesse cut me off on one of my favorite jokes where I said I didn't need you to tell me what day it was. And then I immediately followed it up with Welcome to PW. But Jesse comes on with his fucking godlike Morgan Freeman voice and covered it up.
Voice. I heard it. I still heard it. I appreciate the call, but I still heard it.
All right. Well, that's the rest of this week. Until then, thank you guys for tuning in. We'll see you on Tuesday for the first episode of
tomorrow.
What's tomorrow?
E&E.
Yeah.
Jurassic Park
tomorrow. Get your dinosaurs out, ninjas.
We're very busy.
Jesse, to go over there and tell Shelby to take us out.
She can't hear you.
Okay. Hold on, I got a button for it.
Why would you do this?